to Alexander Titov. He is a lecturer at the School of History, Anthropology, Philosophy, and Politics at Queen's University in Belfast. Thanks so much for being with us. You know, Russian action in Syria, I imagine, is seen differently from inside of Russia versus outside. So I want to start with inside the country. Are Russians happy with Putin's decision, I mean, to sacrifice their military, really, for the good of Bashar al-Assad?
Well, I don't think they said that he was sacrificing Russian military for Assad's benefit. I think they were see it as he's pursuing Russia's interest in the Middle East by establishing Russia's presence and flouting Russian clout in one of the key regions in the world.
Okay, so inside Russia, it's been good. Outside, though, it's caused some complications for Russia, but Putin can play that out in his favor back at home, correct?
I think so, yes. I mean, there are obviously various pros and cons to Russia's involvement. I mean, militarily, they did turn the tide of the war in Assad's favor, and they, as you mentioned, they established a permanent basis, and they become a key player in the Middle East, so that nothing's been decided in Syria without Russia's involvement. But at the same time, yes, there's been higher risk conflict with other major powers such as Turkey and the United States, which came very close in many occasions in Syria. And also, there's still unclear what's the end game for Russia in Syria is, because Assad is there, but he is weakened and relying on Russian help, both militarily and presumably financially at some point. So, so far, so good. But what's the long-term advantages? It's still too early to say, I think.
Right. I mean, that's what I wanted to ask you. What are the long-term advantages? And I mean, how much longer can Russia carry on this support?
Well, that's a good question. I think they obviously want to establish themselves permanently militarily with two bases, one naval base and one air base. Well, I suppose that those limited air bases, they can be there for a long time. But again, you know, how far is Assad be able to survive, and what financially, I mean, if militarily it's been settled, financially it's still unclear. The Russia won't be able to rebuild Syria by itself, has no interest and has no money for that. And at some point, they'll have to look for an exit. That exit is, at the moment, is not clear at all.
Right. And I mean, what about the rest of Russia's conflict intervention right now, and how the war in Syria factors into that? I mean, it's not straightforward, I guess, but still, when you're involved in Libya and now Armenia, and seemingly always at odds with Turkey, which could be a great partner for Russia, how does it all fit? It's hard to see what the beneficial pattern of all the conflicts involved really is for Russia here.
Well, first of all, Armenia and Azerbaijan is something completely different. This is Russia's traditional sphere of influence. It has a very close tie with both countries, military bases there since the Soviet times. So it's very different from Syria or Libya, where Russia is basically can get up and leave without losing any kind of, you know, long-term strategic advantages. So Armenia and Nagorno-Karabakh is something else. With Libya, yeah, I mean, Russians is taking opportunity, seeing openings and taking opportunity of various conflicts. Some of them are more important for them than others. And it does seem to involve that Turkey is, you know, pursuing also very kind of opportunistic policies in various regions, particularly obviously Syria is a kind of very important for strategically for Turkey. It's very important for it for a variety of reasons. I mean, Libya and perhaps, and then certainly Armenia and Azerbaijan and less so. So in a sense, they're mirroring each other. Russia's interfering in Syria, which is much more important to Turkey, but Turkey seems to be getting involved in on the Azeri side now, which is, well, rival Russia. So yeah, there is a kind of potential for conflict with Turkey, which basically they have a lot of things in common in terms of their kind of worldviews on relations with the West, economic cooperation and so forth. But those military adventures do seem to put them on a collision course.
Okay, Alexander Titov, unfortunately we are out of time. Thank you, though, for your analysis there. We appreciate it.